Welcome back, everybody. Let's keep talking about sampling distributions, and specifically, the distribution of sample means. In our last video, we learned that from a parent population of individual scores, we were able to create a distribution of all possible sample means. Let's go through one more example. This example is going to be a little bit different. Because we understand the steps now, because we understand the basic math, in this example, I've attached more meaning to the numbers, so this is going to feel a lot like analyzing a real research study. Based on hospital records, a researcher contacted families with kids who suffered lead poisoning. And remember, lead poisoning is not a good thing. When kids ingest lead, it interferes with brain development, and that's not good. He administered a standard IQ test to each kid, and there are 25 kids in the sample, and he found a sample mean of 95. Remember, in the population, an average IQ score is 100. And it reminds us of that. In the population, IQ scores form a normal distribution with a mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 16. What is the probability of finding such a low sample mean just by chance? We just found that these kids have an IQ lower than average. Why did we find that difference? Did we find that difference just simply due to sampling error? Or can we effectively rule out sampling error and conclude that the differences we found are because these kids were exposed to lead? So let's go ahead and figure out what's the probability of finding such a big difference, a difference of 5 points, just due to sampling error. All right, let's have at it. This example is no different than the examples we've already looked at. Every single example is the same. The numbers are just a little bit different. So you should be able to master these. Let's start by labeling up this distribution. Remember, this is a distribution of sample means. So I'm going to label that axis with an X bar to show that we are graphing sample means. And those sample means were created from this parent population right there. That parent population had a mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 16. If the parent population had a mean of 100, then the expected mean of this distribution should be 100. And that mean is located right there in the middle. In that distribution of sample means, there's obviously some variability. And that variability is measured by the standard error of the mean. Eventually, we're going to take some sample means and we're going to transform them into z-scores. For example, the expected mean of 100 transforms into a z-score of 0. I need to figure out where is a sample mean of 95. 95 is clearly to the left of 100, but where is it exactly? We can transform 95 into a z-score and then figure out exactly where it is. Before we can use this z formula, we need to compute the standard error of the mean. So let's compute it. We need to know the standard deviation from the parent population, and we also need to know the square root of the sample size. The standard deviation from that parent population is 16 points on an IQ test. We need to divide by the square root of the sample size. The sample size is 25. The square root of 25 is 5. So the standard error of the mean can be found by taking 16 and dividing by 5. That equals 3.2. So in other words, the sample means differ from 100 by about 3.2 points on average. Well, with that said, let's go ahead and transform 95 into a z-score. So we're going to take that sample mean of 95, plug it in, subtract the population mean, which is 100, and then divide by the standard error of the mean, which is 3.2. We're left with negative 5 divided by 3.2. So let's key in 5, I'm going to make it negative, and divide that by 3.2. That equals a z-score of negative 1.56. Negative 1.56. That means that a sample mean of 95 is 1.56 standard errors below the mean. Let's just estimate that it's maybe somewhere right around here. That's where we would find our sample mean of 95. And that transforms into a z-score of negative 1.56. We need to figure out what's the probability of finding a sample mean of 95 or lower. In other words, What's the probability of finding our data, or data more extreme, just by chance? Well, you know what we need to do. We're going to need to look up 1.56 in the Z table and find the area in the tail. Let's do that. Here's our Z table. We're looking for 1.56. Here it is right here. If I scroll down just a little bit, you can see the column headings. And all the way off to the right-hand side, we see the proportion of area in the smaller region, which is the tail, 0.0594. 0.0594. In other words, a sample mean of 95 or less will only occur by chance about 5.94% of the time. So it's relatively unlikely to find a sample mean of 95 just by chance. Is it unlikely enough to effectively rule out chance and say that these kids are not typical? And that these kids have an IQ that is statistically significantly lower than average? You're going to see in our upcoming videos, it's close, but it's not enough evidence to rule out sampling error. In this situation, we would not have enough evidence to effectively rule out sampling error as a viable explanation for our results. And if sampling error is still a viable explanation for the differences that we see, then the differences that we see, we conclude, are simply due to chance. In an upcoming video, I'm going to show you a four-step process for making those types of decisions. Here's the good news. We already know all the math now. We know everything we need to know about the distribution of sample means. We know everything that we need to know about the standard error of the mean. And we know how to transform sample means into z-scores. We have all the tools that we need to be successful. We have all the tools that we need to do our first inferential test, which will be a z-test. That's really exciting, because now in the upcoming examples, we will be able to analyze research data and then draw conclusions about that data. There's just one more thing I want to cover before we wrap up this video. We talked a lot today about the standard error of the mean. I just wanted to show you that the standard error of the mean is often displayed graphically in research articles. In this graphic right here, we're comparing two different groups. The height of each bar represents each group's mean. Well, remember, not everybody in that group scores at the mean. There's some variability. Well, one measurement of variability that is often reported is the standard error of the mean. And you can see right here, it shows mean scores are reported, and then it says plus or minus standard error. So this right here would represent the average score for group B, and this is one standard error above the mean, one standard error below the mean. When those error bars are more spread out, it represents more variability within that group. When those error bars are closer together, it represents less variability in the group. You do need to be careful, though. You should always look for some type of legend that describes what's being displayed, because these error bars that you see don't always represent standard errors. Sometimes they represent standard deviations, and sometimes they represent confidence intervals, which is something we'll talk about later on. So that can be confusing, but a good graphic should contain a note letting you know what the error bars represent. Well, that's enough for now. In the next video, we're going to start talking about hypothesis testing, and we will learn our first inferential test. I'll see you in that next video. In the meantime, be safe.